Pam Wall is a pioneering cruising sailor who made a name for herself over a lifetime exploring the world under sail with her husband Andy and their two kids, Jamie and Samantha, aboard their iconic Freya 39 Candaric. Pam's life recently has been marked by tragedy, but at 72, she's still remarkably resilient and remains a force in sailing, particularly among women who aspire to follow in her wake.
Well, we're in my backyard, which is very convenient for me mostly because I have my boat right in my backyard. I always tell people I have my boat in my backyard, and they say to me, on a trailer? And I go, no, at a dock right here. You can see Candaric behind me. This is Fort Lauderdale, Florida. This is one of the early islands that was made in the early 50s. As you know, Andy, I grew up in the Midwest, and I moved down to Florida for the climate. And you can see from today why I moved down here, the palm trees and everything like that. But the best thing about this location is that you go down my canal. It's about 4 blocks long. You turn right. You turn to starboard. You go underneath a bridge. You turn to port. And you're out in the Atlantic Ocean. And it's just so easy to access good sailing.
Well, and we're very thankful because our boat, Eastbjorn, is just across the street, thanks to you for setting the dock up for us. But I wanted to start this a little differently than last time. On April 30th was the 4-year anniversary of my mom's death. And that's sort of been a big impact on my life. And I know you've had your own family tragedy. I'm curious what you've learned from that in your life. And I can relate to you a little bit that way. And I know it's a tough subject for me and for you.
Well, I think what happened with my life was that I found a wonderful man. I had 2 beautiful children. We built the boat of our dreams. And we were working on that boat to make it perfect. And we could have gone on for another 10 or 15 years to make it perfect. And I can remember one day Andy saying to me, as he looked at all the yellow sheets on his legal size pad, he said, "Let's just go. Let's just go." And it turns out that, of course, you never think of what's going to happen in the future, really. But what did happen was that we did it. We had a wonderful time. We weren't in a hurry. We did everything we wanted to with a boat that wasn't finished. And Andy died shortly after we got home. And if we had continued to work on the boat feverishly like we had been for years more, we never would have had that wonderful time together. So he was right. Do it while you can. Do it while you're young, Andy, like you are. Do it while, don't have to worry about money. You can always figure out a way of doing that. The boat can be just as simple or as intricate as you want, but don't stay behind because it's not got everything on it. And to me, that was the one lesson about time and fate and the necessity to do things while you can. Now, losing my daughter Samantha was something else. She was very young when she died. She was 35 when she died from cancer. And the lesson that I learned from that is really grasp every minute you have like she did. Enjoy every second that you've got and be happy. And this young lady was happy. And she was happy, I think, because of the life that we had helped to give her. And again, if she had been in school all her life and had known nothing but the other side of our street, she wouldn't have been the same kind of happy person, because she was happy helping children that needed help that she saw around the world that were so much less fortunate than she was. And I think her whole life became important to her to help other children who weren't as fortunate as she was to do what she did. So those are the 2 major things, I think.
I know one of your things, sort of missions now in life and in sailing, is to help other people reach their goals and stuff. But I think, you know, that idea of go now while you can, it's very cliched, but you and I both know exactly how real that is. How do you get that point across to people where they actually listen? Do you find that challenging?
just by repeating it and repeating it and repeating it. And the problem is that some people understand it and some people don't. And some people, because now my whole life is involved with helping other people get going and getting out there. And some of them understand it and some of them don't. But, you know, do it while you can. Don't wait for this or for that or something like that. And sometimes I'm successful and sometimes I'm not. You know, what I do, Andy, when I consult with people about the boat to buy and what to put on the boat and where to go with the boat or what time of season to go with the boat, you know, whether you take your children or how much money you need, I always say to them, everything will take care of itself. Just get out there. Get out there. You know, it's so important.
Well, you were showing us earlier, you have that belaying pin from Wanderer. And one of my favorite, I quote that book all the time. It's one of my favorites, Sterling Hayden. And one of my favorite quotes is the all voyages should start, I think he says, a voyage like life should start on a foundation of financial unrest.
That's exactly right.
And it's kind of humorous in the context of the book, but it's dead on.
It is dead on. And you know, so many people are afraid to leave because they don't have enough of the goodies aboard the boat, or they don't have enough money or something like that. But part of the adventure of sailing is to figure that out underway. And that's exactly what we did, and that's what I try to tell people. They say, well, how can you work when you go around the world? You fall into it. Yeah. You don't seek it. You fall into it. And then you make the best of it while you have it, you know?
So to put this all in perspective, go back in time a little bit. I mean, your mission in life now is to help other people go out there sailing. I'm sort of somewhere in the middle because I am doing it on my own, but also a lot of people get inspired by this kind of me having conversations with people like you. But how did it all start for you? And I know we could sit here for 3 hours and tell the whole story, but I mean, you said you're from the Midwest. I mean, how did you get into this in the first place?
Well, my dad was always a sailor, and he sailed on Lake Michigan every summer of my life, and I was always sailing with him. I didn't learn very much because he was a racing fanatic, and he always had five or six big hefty crew members. Some of them were really cute young guys, you know, so it was really nice for me. I always went with them, and I enjoyed the sailing, and I didn't enjoy the racing so much, but I loved the cruising. We always took a cruise afterwards. And I started school in Washington, D.C. at American University. I began there. And then I realized...
What did you study? What did you go to school for?
Well, I wanted to be a diplomat.
Really?
I wanted to be a worldly diplomat. I wanted to stop wars, and I wanted to be the kind of person who went into countries and talked sense to them and talked what the better thing was than a war. I don't know. I think it was the books that I had read or something like that.
Pretty lofty ambition.
Well, it was. That's why I went to American University, though, which was a very good school for any diplomat, you know, would-be diplomat.
Yeah.
Anyway, I realized that I liked being closer to home, and I ended up going to the University of Wisconsin for the last 4 years or 3 years of my college education. And then I was able to sail on Lake Mendota. See, that's why I could sail. Lake Mendota had a great a sailing club called the Hoofers. As a matter of fact, I was the commodore of it for a couple of years because no one else wanted the job. So I was the only female commodore president of it. It was called Hoofers. Don't ask me why. But that's okay because I love horses too. But after being in Wisconsin for three freezing cold winters, I knew I wanted to move to Florida. And I did. The day I graduated, I got in my car with my dog and high hopes and drove down to Florida and found this house next door, and just was so lucky because in those days you could afford this.
Yeah,
because you've
been here forever. We were talking before that, I mean, there's a giant mansion across the canal here now, and your guys' houses here are still original.
Right.
Which is cool.
Yeah. Yeah, 49 years ago.
Wow.
That was 49 years ago. And then eventually I saw a cute guy walking down the dock, kind of like you, tall, handsome, blue-eyed, blonde-haired. And I went out and I introduced myself to him, and it turned out to be this young Australian who had just come to Fort Lauderdale. He had sailed around Cape Horn to port in 1967.
Wow.
With, you know, no electronics, no communication, a 30-foot boat, a wooden timber boat. He couldn't even stand up in it. And I knew that this man was what I had been dreaming about all my life, but not realizing it.
How old were you?
Me? I was 23.
Wow.
23. And it just so happened he needed a dock. he just got a great job on a 90-foot catch going back and forth to Roatan, and he asked me if I knew any docks. I mean, he didn't even consider me a friend. I was just an acquaintance, and I just happened to have just bought this house. So he brought his little boat here, this 30-footer, and then he disappeared from my life. And about 8 months later, I get a call. You don't remember me, but I've got my boat behind your house, and I've been waiting for his call. Oh. I don't remember him. So I went and I picked him up at the airport, and he said, could I stay for 2 days and get the boat ready? I'm heading further east. I'm going to Europe. And 2 years later, we left together.
Wow.
So, but we did a lot of deliveries together. In between that, we were delivering boats all over the place together. He was a professional captain.
I was going to say, he was professional, and you...
Yeah, so and I would go with him.
I'm curious, because... You obviously knew how to sail before you met him, but you hadn't done any major ocean voyages and stuff like that. How did the dynamic work between the two of you initially, and then how did that evolve?
Well, I'll
because
tell you
of
what,
that, you know, the difference in skill level.
I was never afraid.
Yeah.
I was never afraid, and this boat was tiny. I mean, it didn't even have a head. It just had a bucket. It had a one-burner kerosene stove. We didn't have any tanks in the boat. It had jerry cans of water, wow. You know, and stuff like that. I literally slept on the cabin sole, and the mast step, you know, keel step was right here. I mean, it was a very small boat, but I was in love, and I was young. Mm. And there was no question in my mind that I couldn't do this. And I remember... the first time I was cooking out in the Gulf Stream, and it was a nor'easter when we left, dumb old us, and the pot of porridge that I was cooking on the stove, the gimbaled stove banged, and of course the porridge went all over the cabin, you know, up on the overhead, down on the cabin sole, and Andy laughed at me and he said, you're learning, kid, you're learning, you won't do that again, will you, you know? And that's what it was like. He wanted to teach me everything. Hmm. He did not want me to be a passenger.
Yeah.
He wanted me to be a full-fledged crew member, which is the only way I wanted it. I wanted to know why, how, when, because, you know. And by the time we got to Europe, which was after the summer, because it took us all summer to get there because we went Bermuda, the Azores, and then to Europe, I was a pretty good sailor. I was because of him teaching me the right way.
Yeah.
You know, he wanted to share everything.
Do you use, I mean, his teaching style and your experience, you must use that when you're helping other women
yes,
in particular.
Yes, I do. And you know what the teaching style is? Don't be a know-it-all.
Yeah.
I've been there too. That's the best thing. I've been there too. Let me help you get there. It's kind of like it's kind of like the same thing as, you know, my father could never teach me to drive.
Yeah.
You know, but my sisters could because they were older than me. It's the same kind of thing. If there's no ego involved, I think, in the person who's doing the teaching, it comes across much better. I think.
Yeah, totally.
I always tell people when I give my seminars, I am not a lecturer. Mm. I'm here to share information with you.
Yeah. I think Lynn Party, I think it was her that told me, like, she cringes when someone refers to her as an expert.
Yeah, me too.
Because it's like, well, I've had this experience and this is what I've learned for it, as opposed to telling people this is how you do something.
That's
especially
right.
With sailing, because there's no right way.
Well, there is no right. And I always say to everybody, all I'm going to tell you about is what works for me.
Right.
And then if it works for you, this is a successful seminar.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't work for you, let me know so that I can help other people learn other ways of doing it.
Yeah.
You know, because I am set in my ways. Yeah. Because what works for me, I use.
Yeah.
Why would I not?
Yeah, exactly.
And if I know of another better way, I'd just as soon use that.
Out of curiosity, Andy was Australian.
Yes.
Do you think you were, like, predisposed because of your sort of lofty ideals of being a diplomat to be attracted to a foreigner specifically?
I don't think that it was it at all. I just think he was so cute that it was love at first sight.
Yeah.
I mean, you should have seen me. I was typing at my desk and I saw him walk by, and I went into the ladies' room and pinched my cheeks. I was in those days. I wore mini skirts and big gold hooped earrings. You know, lots of eye makeup, long fingernails. You know, when you're that age. And I ran out, and he looked down at me like, "Who are you?" You know.
So you told me this story last time we were here, but I think it was on that trip, or maybe on the way back, when you actually had an encounter with our boat when it was known as War Baby at the time, which is. When you first told me this, it's the most ridiculous, serendipitous story, but you please share that.
Isn't it like this, though?
It's such a small world when it comes to sailing.
Well, Andy and I had spent 2 years on our honeymoon cruising around Europe on this little boat with no engine or anything. And we were on our way home, the usual trade wind route, and mm-hmm. we stopped in Grand Canary, okay? And we were in one of these harbors that was brand spanking new, so it was clean. Yeah. The one thing about the Canary Islands that drives me crazy is the filth, the dirt, and the spilled oil everywhere. But this mm-hmm. was a brand clean harbor. And in came this beautiful swan. Beautiful swan. This is 1973.
Yeah.
Okay. With a whole bunch of young people, like six really young, to me, they were much younger than me. So they were probably teenagers.
Okay? You were in your 20s then.
So. Yeah, exactly. So, and they were spending money like water. They were going out for dinner. They'd have parties on the boat every night. And they rented a couple of cars. And they would go into the town to go shopping. And you know, they'd see me walking in the hot street with my canvas bag and ask me if I wanted a ride. So they would take me shopping with them, which was really nice when you're getting ready to do a transatlantic from the Canaries to Antigua, you want to go shop. So we decided that they were really nice instead of obnoxious, right? And they were heading towards Fort Lauderdale. And we knew that we wouldn't be home for at least a year and a half because we moved slowly. And they asked if they could rent our dock. And we thought, wow, yeah, that would be great because, you know, money coming in. And they said, we'll pay you whatever you need. And we thought, wow, would you pay us $400 a month? And they said, well, we'll make it $500 a month. And we weren't suspicious of anything. We just thought, great. So we left on very happy terms. They were going to come in here, call my family, tell them they were coming to the dock. Well, my sister worked at a yacht brokerage company right at 17th Street Bridge. Mm-hmm. Now, this is back in 73. And one day she's looking around like she always does, and she sees all these cop cars and all these policemen and all these sort of plainclothesmen coming in, and she's wondering, what's going on? And this beautiful swan comes in, goes to the dock to check in, and these men converge on it and are taking out our friends. Because I told her to watch for this boat.
Where were you at this time?
We were still in probably the West Indies someplace.
You were on your boat.
Yeah, didn't. They went straight from the Canaries to Fort Lauderdale.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're handcuffed and they're taking them off. And she said she could hear chopping and banging, and they were taking axes down and going through the whole boat. And it was a drug boat. And they apparently, from what they heard in the news, was that they had been following that boat ever since it left Africa.
That's the story I heard too, yeah.
When it got to the Canaries, you know, and I said to Jill, that's the boat that was going to come to your dock. This is my sister.
Yeah.
And she said, oh my God, thank goodness.
Jeez.
Thank goodness. It was called War Cry.
War Baby.
Or War Baby.
That's
War
what
Baby.
It was launched at the time.
Yeah, and I've got it right in my logbook there.
That's astounding to me. And you didn't put two and two together until we came in here.
No, never occurred
ago.
To me.
Yeah.
No, and the interesting thing is, you know, to me today, Andy, I don't think of your boat as being gigantic.
Yeah, right.
48-foot boat's not gigantic
anymore. Yeah.
But when we were there on our 30-foot boat, it was probably the biggest, most luxurious boat we'd ever seen in our lives, you know, back then.
Yeah.
It was huge.
Yeah.
It's a bizarre story that...
Everybody knows that boat because it's been around. I mean, it's got that famous history, and then it's been around the Naval Academy. And of all people to have that story, you having that story is just amazing.
But you know what? In a way, it doesn't surprise me.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
It doesn't surprise me. You know, I've crossed tacks with so many people who have something weird and wonderful in common.
Yeah.
Because we're in a wonderful lifestyle, I think. Now, maybe it happens to golfers and people in tennis too. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it does happen with sailors.
So what? All along here, you're on your cruise, you're on your small boat. How were you making a living? I mean, I guess you didn't really need anything more
deliveries.
Than surviving. So that was where the income came from.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we did deliveries all the way across the Atlantic, and then we did them back again. We didn't do it on our way across, but we did it when we got to England, mm-hmm. okay, and Holland and stuff like that. And then when we came home, we just took our time. And then when we got back to the West Indies, we started doing deliveries up and down the West Indies together.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Yeah. I can remember once having to borrow $100 from some good friend of ours in Rowtown. Because we were totally out of money.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget him. His name was Mike McGee. And he just went into his pocket. He gave us $100, which was a lot of money in those, and said, pay me back when you can.
Huh. That's cool.
I mean, that was a lot of money.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know?
Nice to have friends like that, huh?
Yeah, but that's what they... Hey, you do the same for me today, wouldn't you?
Of course, absolutely.
I do the same for you.
Yeah,
yeah.
What, I mean, everybody says to, you know, keep the boat you have and go now, that's kind of thing. So what, at what point did you guys say, all right, this 30-footer's, we need a bigger boat?
Well, first of all, if we'd put another potato chip aboard that boat, it would have sunk, okay? I mean, you know, it only had 26 inches of freeboard,
yeah.
You know. And it's kind of interesting. As we were beating to weather before we got to Falmouth, we were down below. In those days, we never kept a lookout. Mm. We never kept a lookout. We were down below. And what we were doing is we were making a list of all the things we would have on our next boat. And we heard a gunshot go off. Ran up on deck, and that boat was so small that when I came out of the cockpit, or when I came out of the companionway, I would grab the backstay to pull myself. I grabbed the backstay, and the whole backstay just sagged on me. And we looked forward. In those days, you know, you just had Hank on sails. Mm-hmm. Well, our sail happened to have a wire luff in it. And the sail, wire luff, was holding the mast up.
Wow.
And the turnbuckle had broken on the headstay. And it was just a matter of replacing the turnbuckle. It was so easy, and we were underway again. But we both said, you know what? We're ready for a bigger boat. We're ready for a bit. We want to have children. We knew we wanted to have children,
yeah.
And we knew that it would be impossible on this boat. And then a really unknown, to me, most heroic sailor I've ever known, named Bill Nance. Bob Nance's brother.
And that's the Nance and Underwood rigging shop that's
It's his brother.
Okay.
Billy Nance, back in the 50s, had a Virtue. You know what a Virtue
yeah,
is?
The,
it's one
yep.
of the smallest little boats. A 23-foot Virtue
who
with
designed,
no engine.
Who designed is it
Lawrence Giles?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the boat was called Cardinal Virtue.
Yep.
He sailed that boat single-handed beneath the Three Capes.
Yeah.
Beneath the Three Capes. And in the Indian Ocean, the Southern Indian Ocean, he lost his rig. Hmm. And he jury-rigged, you know, like 5,000 miles by himself, no autopilot, no radio, no nothing, to Perth.
Wow.
Okay?
Yeah.
And he decided when he got to Perth and went back on land that he wanted to build a Freya. Okay? Because this is in the heyday of the original Freya that was winning all the Sydney Hobart races, winning every race in Australia. And he started to build a Freya out of steel. And unfortunately, things happened that it didn't work out that he couldn't finish it. I won't go into details because it's very personal. And he wrote to us when we were on our way home. In those days, it was aerograms. That was your only communication.
Huh.
The three-page aerograms. Do you know what I'm even talking
no.
about? They're really lightweight paper.
Yeah.
And you pay for them because they've got the postage on them from anywhere in the world.
Okay.
And you fold them over. And that was the only way to communicate.
Yeah.
Saying that a young man in Petaluma, California, had built a mold of a Freya, and he wanted to buy Carronade from us.
That was
and go back mold. Around Cape Horn and Carronade.
Yeah.
And he would be waiting here with, you know, money in his hand because he knew he wanted to build a bigger boat. And would we sell him Carronade for cash and then go out and start building Gandara? It was just like, again, it was the magic of our life.
Yeah, yeah.
So he took our lines and then he sailed away on our boat and we borrowed my sister's car and drove out to Petaluma.
Wow. And that was the start of
Gandara? That was the start of Gandara.
Wow. And, all right, so start to finish, well, it's still not finished, you'll say, but
no.
How long was it? I mean, what was that like? I can't imagine. I think it's everybody's dream to build their own boat from a hull like you guys did. But what was that like in reality?
Well, don't forget, we had been designing it for a long time, but we never spoke of it again while we were aboard Carronade. You talk about being, you know.
Superstitious, yeah.
Superstitious. We never spoke about the next boat again because we lost that headstay, you know.
Oh, so you equate that to interesting.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, sure.
So we would talk about it on shore, but never while we were aboard. And we knew exactly what we wanted. And Andy was, you know, such a good sailor. He'd done a lot of sailing. He knew exactly what he wanted. And so we knew what layout we wanted. We knew we wanted a flush deck rather than a long cabin trunk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we knew we wanted a sloop. you know, we knew all these things that we wanted. And that's how it all went together, you know. We just, remember, we were hull number one. Nobody had built this fiberglass Freya before. Yeah. So we had to design the deck. And you know what we designed the deck on?
What's that?
A swan.
Uh-huh.
We used a swan. That's why, I don't know if you noticed, but each beam is a little lower as it goes forward.
Yep.
Until it goes flat at the bow. And that came directly from the swans.
Yeah, cool.
And that's back in the 70s.
Yeah, sure.
Because we started laying up the hull in 75. Yeah.
And it's practically, when you're actually using it on the boat, it is the nicest.
So we got a little camber, a little less camber, a little less camber, and then finally up forward, it's flat.
That's my favorite thing about our boat.
And yours,
I mean,
it came directly from the swan design.
Yeah, cool.
Isn't that interesting?
That's awesome, yeah.
Yeah. Well, so we spent 4 months laying up the hull.
You actually laid the hull up, too. I thought the hull was already completed. Oh, wow.
Talk about living with fiberglass. I had to buy the fiberglass. I had to find it and buy it.
Wow.
And then get it there.
Yeah.
And it was a two-part mold. We put the two parts together. We glassed them together. Mm-hmm. And then we put the lead in, 10,000 pounds of lead, 100-pound pigs at a time. Jeez. So what Andy would do, I bought the lead and got it to this warehouse. And then Andy would put one 100-pound pig on his shoulder, walk up an aluminum ladder that would go like this, you know, and then slide down the bare fiberglass hull and place it just so, because you don't want any voids.
Yeah.
And finally, you know what I did? I went out and I learned how to drive a mini forklift. And I drove the forklift on the highway back to this warehouse.
No way.
And I would put 5 pigs on the, so he'd only have to come up this slippery fiberglass hull instead of going up this ladder. And 10,000 pounds, 100-pound pig each.
And when, from that point, how long was it until you had the boat back here to your house?
Well, we had it trucked back,
so
it came back in 10 days. And then we were very lucky. There was a boat place that had just gone out of business, that had gone bankrupt, just 3 streets over on 15th Street, 16th Street. And my father went to the bank and said, you know, this boatyard, it's covered, it had a big Tammy lift, it had a woodworking shop, it had a metalworking shop. You really need someone to look after this place. You better have a guard. And if you pay my kids $100 a month, they'll keep their eye on it.
Wow.
If they can put their hull underneath there and you know, get it waterproof.
Yeah.
And we did for the next year. And then, of course, we launched it and then towed it here.
Yeah.
And then spent the next 10 years building it.
Wow. Well, and were you still doing deliveries and stuff during that time?
No, by that time, Andy had his own rigging business.
Oh, cool.
And I was working for a company called Maxshaw Sailmakers.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, of course, we had 2 kids interspersed with that, too. 2 children, 2 beautiful children.
Yeah.
And finally, you know, 10 years later, Andy said, let's go.
Well, I want to
ask... Come on, kid, let's go.
I want to ask you, because I grew up as a cruising kid, not quite as extensively as your kids did, but how did your previous travels, like, impact, not just on the boat, but just in general, how you raised your kids?
My parents sent me and my sisters wherever we wanted to go that was bizarre and unusual for the time we lived in.
Huh.
I mean, I went to school in Switzerland when I was 15 years old.
Wow.
Because I wanted to learn French.
Yeah.
I wanted to learn French. Okay? And I went to school in Matreux. And my parents were travelers. My parents were spur-of-the-momenters. My parents probably spent all their money on having a good time. And they believed in, you know, like anti-Maine. Live, live, live! Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And so I guess that was in my blood as well. And that I tried to pass on to my children,
sure,
which I did. My kids used to say, oh, if you can't live in Paris, why live at all? You know, that sort of thing.
Nice.
I mean, they when they came home from sailing around the world, of course, we tell them back to go to school in France. Mm-hmm. And after they graduated from school, they were never home more than a couple of months at a time.
Really?
Yeah. They had the wanderlust just like we did.
How old were they when you first took them cruising?
Well, from the time they were born, because
really?
I have pictures of Samantha crawling on the foredeck in her diapers, looking down the forehatch and stuff like that.
I mean,
seriously, they were on the boat 2 weeks after they were born.
Yeah.
Don't forget, the way we built this boat was totally different from everybody else. We got it sailing first.
Yeah.
We waterproofed it.
Yep.
Put an engine in it. put a 1 pound, a 1 gallon header tank so we could run the engine, you know, with no tanks in it.
Yeah.
And we rigged it and we bought sails for it. And we would sail it all the time. Believe it or not, she used to have a tiller.
Oh yeah, cool.
And I was so pregnant, I couldn't pull the tiller. When we were hard on the wind,
yeah.
I couldn't pull it into my stomach. So Andy said, screw this, we're gonna put a wheel on, you know, that sort of thing. You know, you learn from your own mistakes.
Wow.
And Jamie made his first passage to Bermuda when he was 10 months old. But I mean,
that's
he'd
so
been
cool.
sailing with us, you know, up and down the coast, up to Maine,
yeah.
over to the Bahamas, from the time he was out of the womb as well. They both had.
Wow.
So it wasn't a big transition for them at all.
Yeah, yeah.
Not at all.
But then you guys did decide to go long-term cruising and went around the world with the kids, right?
Right.
How old were they when you left on that trip?
Jamie was 4 and Samantha was 7.
Did you have a plan as to how that was going to go, or did you just let it rip, like with schooling and just the
no
way...
No plan. We told my mother we'd be back in 2 years maximum, and we didn't have enough money, and we just left. And it worked out. Sterling Hayden was right.
Yeah.
Because by the time we got to Tahiti, we both were ready to go to work because we had to. So we put the children in real school there for a year. It was fabulous. We both got jobs there. It was fabulous. We became part of the community. It was fabulous. We did not just sit on the boat in the harbor having sundowners.
Yeah, well, that's...
That's what, not seeing the world. Yeah. We became a part of the community, and we both had wonderful jobs, and the kids had great school friends. Because their age difference, which was 3.5 years, they couldn't go to the same school, so we had 2 different schools. And we made enough to continue westward. And then when we got to New Zealand, we did the exact same thing. We both got jobs, put the kids in school, real school, again, which was great. It was a bad year to be there. It was during the America's Cup.
Oh, wow.
When Michael Fay, you know, was trying to take the America's Cup away from Dennis Connors,
wow.
we had to literally take our American flag and put it down below.
Oh, really? It was that much nationalism? Wow.
You think that we're, you know, we watch sailboat racing, that it ain't nothing compared
yeah,
to New Zealand.
Totally.
I mean, in New yeah. Zealand, wow.
Yeah.
I mean, we would have people finger us, we'd have people moon us, and then we decided just take the flag down
wow.
and hope they didn't know where Miami Flaw was. You know what I mean? It was really something. And my poor
wow.
kids were chastised a lot at school.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Because they were Americans,
yeah.
and Dennis Connors was hated by everybody.
Yeah. Wow. Interesting.
So, yeah.
How did the kids, I mean, they obviously didn't have a choice. Like, I didn't have a choice when my parents
yeah.
dragged us off. But how did they adapt? I mean, parents are concerned about, like, oh, you know, taking them out of their comfort zone and stuff. How did they adapt?
Oh, they didn't have to adapt.
Yeah.
I mean, to them, it was life.
Yeah.
They didn't know any other life because they were so young when we left. You know, that's why it's hard to take teenagers. But they didn't know any other life. We were always sailing. As we built the boat and had it sailing, we would go away to the Bahamas. We'd go up to Maine with them. They were always on the boat until we left to sail around the world.
Yeah.
So there was no adjustment for them at all. I think the worst adjustment for them was leaving a place that we had spent a year and
sure,
saying goodbye
yeah,
to their friends.
Yeah, yeah.
So there was no adjustment. I was, before you arrived here today, I was looking at some videos
mm-hmm.
that I put on a DVD of the kids when they were young, and you know, to them it was life.
Yeah.
They didn't think it was anything special.
Yeah.
But no.
Did you, like, besides the schooling they had locally in places, did you guys homeschool them on the boat?
Yes. No. Yeah. But when they were in Tahiti, they went to real school.
Yeah.
When they were in New Zealand, they went to real school. And I didn't get as far as Australia, but we stayed for a year in Australia too, and they went to real school there. Then from their home, it was all, they used the wonderful Queensland School of Distance Education from Australia. You know, that's for the outback kids.
Really?
But they used it on the boat.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And they used that till we got home. And then when they got home, they were so far ahead of everybody.
Yeah.
They didn't know anything about American history, American Indian. They could tell you about the Maori Wars, you
yeah.
know, and you know, the Aboriginals in Australia, but
yeah.
they, and Tahitian history and stuff like that, but they didn't know anything about American history.
Well, there's a couple on a boat called Morning Haze, who they've been on my podcast before as well, but they basically kind of, their kids just by themselves started teaching themselves.
Yeah.
And said, hey, Mom, just leave me alone. As long as I get good grades, just I'll do my work on my time.
That's
she
what
was
they
a little
did
older
too.
Teenager.
When
was
I say when I say, the School of Distance Education left everything in your lap to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
The only thing you did was when you got to port, you'd send everything to them. They'd grade it, and by the next port, which was really exciting to get to, they'd get their grades back.
Oh, wow.
You know what I mean? But it was totally reading, writing, arithmetic, and science, which they had on the boat a lot. But I stressed history and sociology of every country we went to.
That's,
it was really pathetic, because when we got to Tonga, a boat sailed in with a young kid who was just their age at the time. And we asked him where he came from, and he said, Los Angeles. And we said, no. The kids, I heard him saying, what island did you just come from? He said, I don't know. And they said, do you know where you are now? He said, no. You know? I mean, how could people do that? How could people let their kids on this marvelous education not know where they were? Hmm. I just... It's unbelievable.
I mean, this is probably a question for Jamie, but how have you seen that experience has affected his life as an adult? Because he's just a few years older than me, and I know for me, it's literally like defined my quote unquote career path, which is sort of made up.
Well, he was always the artistic one in the family, mm-hmm. and he was always making really neat things out of stupid things like tin foil and you know. Toothpicks practically on the boat, you know. And when he came home, he knew where he wanted to go. He wanted to go to the Rhode Island School of Design. And Andy and I took off for the Bahamas for the whole summer. When we came back, he had done all the paperwork and everything. Wow. And he got a scholarship to Rhode Island School of Design, and he was there for 5 years. And they sent him to Denmark for a year.
Wow.
They sent him to Denmark, and then they sent him to Turkey for a year to study Byzantine architecture. Yeah. And so he loved it. And of course, every place we went around the world had different architecture, and he just loves it. I mean, he just, for some reason, loved architecture.
Do you think, I mean, it sounds like he knew exactly what he wanted to do and went and did it. Do you think that sort of definitive idea of what he wanted to do came from the way you brought them up? Because a lot of kids, I think, nowadays are very unprepared to even pick a major in college, let alone know what they want to do with their career.
I think so. I think, you know, sailing on a small boat, any size boat, but sailing on a sailboat as well, gives you all this responsibility and everything like that. And you start figuring out what you like best about when you get to places and things like that. Sammy liked the children, the poor children, and tried to comfort them and give them gifts and feed them food from our boat and have chocolate pudding parties and things like that
that
they'd never seen before.
Who was
Samantha was.
She was older than
Jamie. Yeah.
Okay.
And Jamie was always building things. He was always building things when he went ashore, out of rocks, out of twigs, out of whatever he could find ashore. So I'm not sure if we caused them to do that, but certainly it had an influence on their lives.
Certainly. Yeah, right, just subconsciously, I mean.
Yeah. And they both knew exactly what they wanted to do.
That's really, I think, I definitely would attribute their experience, because I had the same experience. And my sister, and even though she's not in sailing anymore, she always wanted to be a teacher. And, I mean, she's, and I think it's probably even you and Andy as parents, as opposed to the fact that you took them sailing, because my mom was always do what you want to do and encourage that. And so that might have to do with you as a parent as opposed to the experience.
But also taught them. We also taught them. Don't ask us for it. You want it, you go for it, kid.
Yeah.
Don't expect us to give it to you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Or to hand it to you, I should say. We'll always help you and everything. But that's the way it was on the boat with everything, wasn't it? From the time we left Fort Lauderdale to the time we got back, my children had watches. 2 hours on and 6 hours off. You know how young they were to do that? They had to know how to read a compass. They had to know what trimming the sail was. And they certainly had to know what a lookout was.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty young.
Yeah.
4 years old.
Yeah, I'll say.
But I mean, that's the way it was.
Yeah.
That's the way it was. And I think that gives them a little bit of that sort of impetus to know we're on our way to Ambon. Mm. So we've got to make sure it happens.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. There's a
the responsibility.
Goal and responsibilities to make stuff happen.
I think.
What are some of the most common, you must get these questions all the time from people that want to take their kids cruising. What kind
of How'd you keep from being seasick? I am not kidding.
Is that the most common question?
Yes.
Yeah. And what's your answer?
Well, my kids never got seasick. They were lucky. I used to get seasick the first couple of days of every long passage.
Yeah.
The big joke was I would go up in the cockpit and I would steer instead of letting the boat self-steer. Mm-hmm. And I would immediately lose the seasickness, but I never told them that, because for the first 3 days of every long passage, you know, average 10, 15 days or something, mm-hmm. They did all the cooking. So I didn't have to do any cooking.
Nice.
And I never told them I got over the seasickness.
Oh, wow.
You know, but I did, you know.
Yeah.
And what I tell people is, first of all, I think what creates seasickness are two things, fear and smell.
Yeah.
Fear and smell. First one is, know what you're doing so you're not afraid of it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The second one is, I cannot tell you, as a yacht broker, how many boats were so beautiful. I went down below, and seriously, the smell would knock you over.
Mm-hmm.
Dirty bilge,
yeah.
Dirty bilge, oil, diesel, shower water, hoses from a dirty, stinky toilet. I mean, that would make you sick right away.
Yeah.
Right away. So I try to keep my boat as odor-free as possible.
I even find weird stuff. Like, there's a particular, the yellow dish soap, Joy. Yellow,
yeah.
Joy dish soap does it to me. I can't stand that
smell
at sea. It's fine in the house.
I know. And then also cooking, you know.
Yeah.
Don't do stupid cooking things, you know, and stuff like that. So, and we have fans, you know, every cabin's got all these fans, you know, and we have hatches that are open most of the time.
Yeah.
So that's how I combat my seasickness. And then I discovered this great drug called Stewedron,
mm-hmm.
which isn't sold in this country. And if I ever did get seasick, one pill and psht, it was gone.
Hmm, really?
Yeah.
A lot of people say that. I've thankfully, knock on wood, don't get seasick. But
you should have some aboard your boat.
We have a variety of stuff.
I think
we might still have some of that, because you can get it like in Bermuda.
You can get it in Bermuda, Ireland. You know, the BVI. It's sold right over the counter in the BVI,
yeah.
But it's not approved here. It's for pregnant women who get nauseated. How safe can that be?
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean?
That's weird.
So,
So how long was your circumnavigation? How long were you gone?
6.5 years.
Really?
Yeah.
How do you come back from that?
Horribly. Well, Bob Nance was standing here with his brother Bill, took our lines and said, you're coming to work for me tomorrow. Bob Nance learned the rigging business from Andy. He sailed here on Su Hung, the Smeaton's boat.
Oh, yeah,
Su Hung.
Yeah.
And he lived
That's
here.
So
he
cool.
bought it from the Smeaton's, you know,
Bob
after
Nance
they successfully did? Rounded Cape Horn.
Wow.
You know.
So wait, did Bob Nance know, did he sail with...
Andy.
No, I know, but did he know, who was the guy that sailed with the Smeatons?
Oh, yeah, John Goswell.
Yeah.
Of course they did.
Did you know them as well?
Oh, yeah.
As well.
Oh, yeah, we know Johnny. But
that's so cool.
So Bob, after he successfully rounded the horn and took and sailed with the Smeatons over to Poland, he bought the boat from the Smeatons and then brought it here and lived here for 2 years on his boat on Su Hung, the beautiful Su Hung.
Wow.
And learned the rigging business. He had no work, so he was Andy's apprentice and he learned how to be a rigger.
Huh.
Then when it was time for us to leave, okay, he took over Andy's rigging business.
Cool.
And that's how Nance and Underwood started.
Really?
Roger Underwood came to work and applied for a job at Mack Shaw Sailmakers. I was the office manager. And I hired him to be a sailmaker. And they got together and formed Nance and Underwood Rigging.
Huh.
Okay. I can't remember what the question was.
No, I said, how do you come back from a
so
trip like
Andy
that?
And I went, when we came home, and Bob had started Nance and Underwood.
Yep.
And we went to work for Bob. Okay, that didn't work. I won't go into why, but everybody wanted Andy to do the rigging because they figured it was his business before.
Yeah.
Anyway, and West Marine was just digging the hole for the second store west of the Mississippi.
Mm-hmm.
First one was Miami. And so I went and applied for a job there. Got it immediately, and Andy went back to his old rigging business.
Huh.
Now, the kids had a harder time. Kids went to real school.
How old
school.
Were the kids when you got back?
Let's see. Jamie would have been 10 or 11, and Samantha would have been 13.
Okay.
And they had to go to two different schools.
Yeah.
And both of them were foreigners in their own schools.
Sure.
They were just so weird.
Yeah.
They didn't know how to go to a football game, or they didn't know what soccer was. They didn't go to dances. They didn't do drugs. They didn't smoke. You know, they could windsurf and scuba dive and all that. You know, they could sail any boat. And they said, we don't mind being foreigners in a foreign country. That's kind of cool. But we don't like being foreigners here.
Yeah.
And so I went to the Rotary and the Rotary has this thing called this, the Youth Exchange Program. Mm-hmm. And even though they were well under the age, they have a limit. You can't do it until you're 18. And they were much younger. They had to write a thesis why they thought that they could do it. Mm. Well, but they both spoke French. And they also, Rotary says, we'll tell you where you're going. And they said, no, the only place we're going is France.
Wow.
Sorry. And they put that in their thesis.
Yeah.
Both of them. So they wrote this thesis. We took it back to them. And it was about 2 weeks. And they gave them, you know, Rotary pays for everything, sends them someplace in France. Luckily, they went to this most beautiful town called Vannes in, you know, the southern part of Brittany. Oh my God, it was a fairy tale. So we sailed them over there.
Really?
Yeah.
No way.
It was just, you know, we left from here, took them over, and then sailed back home again.
I didn't hear that.
I took a leave of absence from West Marine for 1 year.
Huh.
In those days, they let me do that.
Yeah.
And still have my original job back. And so we left in June and came back on June 21st. We left June 21st and we came back on June 21st.
No way.
Yeah.
What a cool experience. And then did the kids stay?
They stayed over there. They finished high school and started, Sammy, because she was older, started university. And they moved from Vannes down to Toulouse because Sammy had to go to university in Toulouse. And then we decided, better get your degrees here. And Jamie knew he wanted to be an architect, and he knew he wanted to go to RISD, so they came home, and the rest is history. He went to RISD, Sammy went to Nova Southeastern University. They both graduated with honors and started working in the professions that they wanted to.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
I think most people know, like, Pam Wall, the brand, so to speak. That must have started when you got hired by West Marine, and you started sort of your career, so to speak, on this leading towards the helping other people go sailing.
That's it.
How has that sort of evolved? And I'm curious specifically because you're such a humble person, and it would seem to me anyway that you might have trouble with being a brand as well as a person. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, is that difficult?
Oh, it is very difficult, you know, because I don't feel like I'm known at all. I just want to do is help other people.
Yeah.
And West Marine, what happened was I was working at West Marine. I started out as a cashier, became an assistant manager. Then they started having seminars around the country in different stores. And I said, I can do that. I'll tell people about sailing around the world. I'll get them excited. They'll want to buy a boat. They'll want to come to West Marine. And they sent me to almost every store that they owned at the time around the country, giving this family sails around the world presentation. That's how it all started. Then the boat shows started having seminars. Then I started giving seminars for West Marine at the boat shows. Then I morphed into this job at West Marine that I was their cruising consultant and outfitting manager.
That basically was invented for you, right?
I wasn't paid by the store. I was paid by headquarters.
Really?
Because it was a job description for headquarters.
Yeah.
I wasn't a sales associate. And that's what I had, you know, my own little office, you know, and everything like that. And it was wonderful. And they sent me to all the boat shows and everything. And, you know, I owe that all to the year in Australia, because when we got to Australia and wanted to work and put the kids in school there was a place called Whitworth's Nautical World. And Craig Whitworth was the partner of, what was his name? It was Miller and Whitworth. And Miller was Ben Lexan. Ben changed his name from Miller to Ben Lexan, you know, the famous yacht designer.
Uh-huh.
And when Andy left Australia in this 30-foot boat, he was the largest yacht to ever buy sails from Miller and Whitworth, sailmakers. And I saw an ad in the paper that Whitworth's Nautical World wanted a sales associate. So I called up and I asked to speak to Mr. Whitworth, because Andy said, oh, he'll never remember me or anything. And I said, I called him up and I talked to him for a few minutes. And I said, you may remember my husband, Andy Wall, on a little boat called Carinate. He said, do I remember him? I got so much marketing hype from him going around Cape Horn with my sales.
Oh, wow.
And he said, I don't even have to interview you. You got the job. And so I started working at a marine store instead of a sail loft.
Yep.
And for that year, and I loved it. It was like a jewelry store to me.
Oh, yeah, sure.
It was like a jewelry store. So Andy worked for Kenny Bischel, Bischel's Boat Yard, famous people in Australia for building beautiful wooden boats. Mm-hmm. And we were in Elvina Bay on a mooring, and I took a bus into Brookvale, which was a suburb of Sydney, every day, and the two kids went to real school.
Wow.
Yeah. So fantastic. West Marine was just a continuation of the wonderful time I had in Australia.
And how long did you, because West Marine, just recently, they just kind of ended that, didn't they?
They ended everything.
And it's part of, like, recently they've been going away from sailing and into, you know, water sports more and
more. I don't know. I don't know.
But you're still...
That life of mine, just my life with Andy and like my life with Samantha, is over.
Yeah.
And it wasn't happy, the ending. And now I'm moving on. I'm with you and Mia.
But you, I mean, you're still passionate about the teaching and stuff. And that
I'm still going to be doing that. I'm going to be looking for new sponsors. And I have a couple already who have committed.
Cool.
I love the teaching. This Cruisers University where we met last year, not met for the first time, but where we were.
Yeah.
This year I had so much fun.
I missed that this year.
Wow, it was so good. Oh, cool. It was so great. And people would come up to me and say, you know what? You were the best of everyone.
Oh.
We just canceled all the others and came to yours if we went to one of yours. Because I think it's because I'm enthusiastic and I'm not lecturing. I'm
and
not
you're
a
also
lecturer.
Not really selling anything either.
I'm not selling anything. Yeah. I'm selling the dream, mm-hmm. and I'm selling the knowledge that they need. I'm selling the education that they need to feel comfortable. You know, that's what people come to that university for.
Do you have any, like, favorite success stories of people that you've helped over the years?
Oh, I have
anything
so like, many.
I know you have tons, but what's one that comes to mind?
Well, just right across the street, when I was in Oakland, I met a family, a little boy, actually it was his grandparents, Carla and Joe Barrett, and they said to me, we want to buy a boat and we want to do what you've done. And I helped them buy the boat. Then they bought the boat here, not to your dock, but to the one just to the west of it. Then they outfitted the boat. Then they went to the Bahamas, and if you ever watch them on Facebook, they're having the best time, the best time. That's only one, okay? That's only one. I met a young lady in the Chicago boat show that she said she actually came up and introduced herself to me because she said she'd seen me in other boat shows, but she wanted to say hello to me. Came to every single seminar I gave at the Chicago boat show. And then she came to me and asked me to help her buy a boat. I helped her buy a boat. It was a really nice CNC 39 plus. She kept it right here for about 4 years, living aboard it. And she and I are best friends. She's living here in Fort Lauderdale now. She's got a beautiful little Cape Dory that she's got now, living ashore though. And we're best friends in the whole world, as a matter of fact. And she lives right down the street. I mean, there are literally dozens of people that I still correspond with today who say to me, thank goodness you pushed us to do this. Yeah. And thank goodness you pushed us to do it the right way.
That's great.
You know.
Well, Pam, it's getting dark,
yeah.
but I want to ask you, it sounds stupid for me to even be thinking this far ahead, but probably because of, you know, we started with my mom having passed away and stuff. In the career that you've had and that I'm sort of creating now, it's not traditional, obviously, and there's no traditional end to it in quote-unquote retirement. So do you think about that? I mean, both emotionally and financially, because that's something, there's nobody paying my pension. So how do you, what do you do now?
Well, my situation, which is different from everybody's, everybody's got a difference, is that I have to work till I can't work anymore.
Yeah.
Okay. I think I would go stark raving mad if I didn't, to tell you the truth.
That's the way I feel now, but I'm 32. I don't know
but
how I'm going to feel.
However, I still have my boat,
which
is a family member that I use. And the only time Jamie and I are at total peace with our tragedies is when we're on that boat together. It's like that boat encompasses our beautiful life as a family, and that's when we're the happiest, okay? After leaving West Marine, I was pretty far down in the ground because I lost not only my daughter, my husband, but I lost my West Marine family. And out of the clear blue sky, an old friend of mine, old cruising friend, called me up and he said, I want you to start working for me tomorrow. And it was Steve Dasher, the famous boat designer of the Deerfoots, the Sundeers, the Beowulfs, and stuff like that. And I, it was a job made in heaven for me. I can work right from my house. What I do is I outfit all his beautiful aluminum yachts that he's building in New Zealand.
Yeah.
I mean, everything from soup to nuts. And and I find it all, I purchase it all, I containerize it all, and I ship it all to New Zealand. And occasionally I get a trip to New Zealand out of it too.
Can't beat that.
And Skip Dashew and his wife Linda and his daughter Sarah are just so wonderful to work with. But it's kind of like working with a genius.
Yeah.
Like the Einstein of the cruising community. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He is so brilliant. And I'm learning from him so much. And I hope I'm helping him.
And it's, the takeaway I have is that you just, in general, being in the life, so to speak, you love it enough that you don't think about retirement in the traditional sense.
No, I love this job. I don't even consider it a job. I find it just continuing the fun things that I've always done in my life is outfitting boats, really, and working with cool people.
Yeah.
And all his customers are cool people. They're not customers, they're friends.
Yeah.
You know?
That's
just
fantastic.
Like, I always say to people, I've never had a customer at West Marine. They've all become my friends.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Pam, what didn't I ask?
I don't know, Andy. I just, what we can do more together to get people out there sailing.
Definitely. I love this. It's so cool. I mean, this is literally me pinching myself because you've been a hero of mine, you know, growing up and stuff. And it's just, but that, like you said before, when you meet people in sailing anyway, in my experience, I've had the privilege of meeting a lot of my heroes, and you're one of them. And every single one of them's super friendly, down to earth, and helpful, and it's just a really nice community to belong to. I love it, and I'm super thankful that you've taken me.
Oh, Andy, well, for me to be able to work in the marine industry like I am now, and still helping people, besides that, I mean, to me, it's a tremendous fulfillment, and that boat is just as much a part of the reason I'm sitting here with you as well, and to me. To me, if I could share the enthusiasm and the knowledge that I've gained over all the years of sailing with other people, I will be a happy camper for the rest of my life.